thank you, Pastor David. It's good to be here with you. Lots of good memories, and certainly. Sometimes I wonder where the time went. Yeah, I remember when you had little kids, and you were also much younger. But he always had an incredible sense of humor, an amazing fashion sense. He was also humble. Intelligent. Where was I? Okay, all right, never mind. And I know these things because he told me. it's a pleasure to be here. It's one of these seasons in life where, you know, every bit of time, money, emotional margin that we've had is just like evaporated, and maybe probably negative for a lot of us. And just don't know how to think about stuff, how to feel about stuff, and everybody's in the same boat. And, you know, and think about this, you know, we've got Jesus. Can you just imagine what I'd be doing without Jesus, right? I see this day as a day of opportunity, if not immediately, eventually, and to order our thoughts aright. Also to watch the character of our witness, that we would be seen, even if people don't agree with us, even if people malign us, that we would be maligned for the right things. You know, it's like a child who says, oh, I don't like these rules. And then one day they wake up and they realize, you know, that wasn't half bad. You know, that was okay. That was pretty good. That was good for me. And of course, Christianity is more than rules. There's redemption there. And we're in the midst of a society that does a lot of things well, but redemption is not one of them. And that's something very, very specific to the Christian worldview. So I've been looking forward to this. I'm glad that it didn't get canceled because, oddly, I spend pretty much every waking hour working in my current role in a Bible college and seminary, focusing on the importance of worldview to education. That's the whole reason we exist. And I've never really presented on it anywhere other than to our staff and to our students and our board and all that kind of thing. So it's good to be able to be with you. So tonight we're going to look at the importance of biblical worldview in the stories that we tell. Because really, no matter how you look at education, if you look at education subject by subject, you're telling a story. In a way, biology is a story of life. History is a story of, I love history because tell me a story. It's full of stories, right? And theology is the story of God. And there's even a liberal arts perspective. The artes liberales, that which a man needs to know to be free, as that's what the liberal arts used to mean. There's this foundational, broad foundational base of understanding that makes everything else understandable and profitable. Even that is a story. You know, how does my mind reconcile what I see in the world and what I know to be true about the world? So it's exciting for me. But I wanted to start with a Bible verse, Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9. You know this, likely. The Jews called it the Shema, and it's the only line of Hebrew that I can do by in Hebrew. But okay, it says this, Hear, O Israel. That's English. Hear, O Israel. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Here we have a command to educate our children with a certain content, and we're told how to deliver this content. This is the stuff educators wrestle with all the time, and they write thousands of pages about, and God did it in five verses. Six verses. So that's what he did. Everything but math. No, so it's right there. It's right there. And there's still a lot of questions to ask and everything else. I heard somebody say recently, I can't remember who it was, so we'll say Yogi Berra, said, you have to do more with worldview than analysis. There has to be some action that goes along with it. And I agree with that. And I think our time together tonight and tomorrow morning is going to be a little short on the action side of things. But I think what I'll be able to show you tomorrow morning is that what God does give us instruction on how to act where we can act in such a way that it will free us from the tyranny of, what do you do? There's so much to do. I don't know what to do. And you end up doing nothing. It's like if there's six deer, so you don't shoot any of them. You know, you gotta pick something and go with it. And if you're anti, I'm sorry. Okay. All right. I once said, there's more of this. You can't throw a dead cat around here without hitting that. And I heard it, and I realized. I said, Michelle, they're sensitive about cats, dead cats. Yes, Wade, you shouldn't say that. It's yes, dear. Okay. All right. So that'll be tomorrow. But tonight, it's going to be a little bit more analysis. So I want to tell you a little bit of about me, if you would. I love my family. It's Hannah and Ben. They are 10 and, they're both, this is the time of year where they're both, they're 10 and 11. Yeah, okay, so they're 8.5 months apart. Ready? Okay. Hannah's adopted, and we were 2 weeks pregnant with Ben and didn't know it. Okay? I still don't know where babies come from. So, but that was, it's crazy. 9 years, no kids, and then we adopt Hannah, and something's not right, and this was the tip-off. Michelle loves popcorn, and she got physically sick when she's eating popcorn. I said, something's wrong. Something's wrong with Buttercup here. So anyway, 2 weeks, and so we had 2 kids just like that. They love each other, unless, you know, right? But they're best friends, and they're a lot of fun. And Michelle's a great, great partner in ministry. We currently serve at the Free Lutheran Bible College and Seminary, 2-year college-level school of the Bible. Can't get a degree there, but it is accredited, and you can take a bunch of your credits and go on and finish someplace else. Lancaster Bible College is one place that they're part of, an association that we're a part of too. A school like that takes all of our credits just like that, and increasingly, secular schools now are taking our credits too, which is, it's nice. I'm not hanging my hat on that happening forever. But then 4-year master's level pastoral training program as well. And that's in Minneapolis. The campus website looks like that. In the Bible College, we say start here, go anywhere, grounded in God's Word. So you can't finish there, but it's a great place to start and get that. Yeah, so whatever you're going into it with a solid foundation, whether you get done in 4 years or 6 years or whatever. It's that important. It's that crucial. And then we drive that home to our students that this is foundational. All this is foundational. Our campus looks a little bit like that. That's some drone work, and you can see to your right, way in the back, you can see that's the city of Minneapolis. That's the tall buildings, and until May 31st or so, we really played up Minneapolis, and now it's kind of like we can barely see the smoke from here, and it's really sad. That's a joke, but I shouldn't have joked about it, because honestly, there was from my chiropractor's office, which isn't too far away, it's a little bit up on a hill, not quite as high as yours, but you really could see smoke early June coming out of South Minneapolis. And just today, I talked to a pastor friend from Detroit. As I was flying through, I texted him and said, hey, I'm in Detroit. He said, I just thought of you too. I met a guy doing some work at the church who just moved here from South Minneapolis. He said he gave it 3 months and he couldn't do it anymore. Because his whole neighborhood was just constant turmoil and violence. And it's not like that all over. Our campus is very safe. We're a long way away from that. But it does, it gets your heart. These precious, eternal human souls who are down there, many, most of them, they're not burning their own neighborhoods. They're trapped. And it's very, very, very sad. We're trying, it's not safe right now to do anything, but we try to give our students a love for the city as well. Not because it's the city, but because there are many souls there. You think of what God said about Nineveh, right? So, and it's not Nineveh. So, all right. Beautiful campus. And we're working on a new building at the gymnasium. This picture's a month old. They've done a lot of work. It started snowing Tuesday. That's not right. That's wrong. Okay? Even in Minnesota, that's not right. It's just like just pure 2020. So inside the gymnasium looks like that. Next year, how many of you have been to an annual conference? Ever been? Okay. Annual conference next year. I think we're gonna be back to normalish by then, right? All right. Okay. Good. Let's just do it. Okay. So that's where the conference is going to be, right in there. It's gonna be beautiful. Got a coffee shop right there, so you don't even have to make your run. So It's kind of cool. So anyway, Esther, that's for you. Not that one. Next one. Next one. Next one, Esther. Yeah, there, that's for you. Yeah, there we go. So we did a little family vacation during August when you couldn't really do anything else. So we just got in the car, drove around the state. Beautiful state. Not right now, but it's a beautiful state. You should visit. Just not right now. So, okay. So what I've just shared with you, it's a little bit of my story. And we share stories when we're introducing ourselves, just standing out here. You always try to find some connection. And then Bob's sister goes to the church where I served for 11 and a half years in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Half of my heart's still there. That's crazy. It's the kind of thing, it's like, did David put you up to this? Yeah. And so I did some texting just to verify, and your story checks out. So, okay. anyway, so we just long for, you know how you do that? You try to find some connection because then you feel like you got something in common. You can build on it. And there's a sense of safety with that, a sense of security or opportunity. The guest speaker always, you should know this because you invite people in. The guest speaker always has a security blanket someplace, and he always tries to find. Okay, so right now I'm with David forever, so he's the security blanket. So I need to find a better security blanket. And anyway, no, but you keep looking to him. Yeah, are we good here? And so we that commonality. It's helpful for us. But knowing people's story is also an opportunity. As you know, I'd love to know your story. I just told you a smidgen of mine. But as a pastor, a lot of times you're just trying to get to know people. What makes them tick? What has shaped their life? And you're not going to tell them that on installation Sunday. It's going to take some time to work up. And one of the joys and privileges of being a pastor is people automatically invite you into stuff that they won't tell nobody. Okay, it's a real opportunity as well. What about the story of the people in the middle of the cities close to here, the middle of the cities in the background of the Bible college? You know, there's 3 million souls within a half hour drive of our Bible college. And that's one of the reasons I don't think we're going to be at 100 students forever. It seems to me that more than 50 students per year need what we have, and we haven't wrung the world dry of prospective students. We got to get them and bring them in and train them up. That's what we want to do. So, but more than anything, I want you to know that there is a story, like a big story in the world, a story that is true, and a story that has an author, and a story that has all of our stories written on the canvas of it. That's really what education is. The passing on of a story from one generation to another. Not just a story, but the story. God's story. So by definition, if we're going to educate people, we have to have a biblical worldview. For if we do not have a biblical worldview, we will have another worldview, and we're going to be telling people a different story, and they can't all be true. Have you had Sean McDowell here yet?
No.
Okay, it seems like you've had a bunch of impressive people here, and me. Okay, so see how I jumped on that?
Yeah,
so I took it away. It's like that was a preemptive strike. Okay.
We have tried to get him. Issachar has tried to get him.
Okay.
We have yet to lock him in.
Yeah, I might be able to help you with that if you can get me Nancy Piercy. Right? Can't get Nancy Piercy. I'm trying so hard, but anyway. All right, here's the next slide is a picture of a little kid on a skateboard. So this is Tim Barnett, who you probably know of, but he the Sean McDowell quote. Sean's going to be on our campus here in a couple weeks. If we do not consciously equip young Christians with a biblical worldview, they will unconsciously absorb the ideas of today's culture. If we do not consciously equip young Christians with a biblical worldview, they will unconsciously absorb the ideas of today's culture. When we throw up our hands and start to, that look, this posture, that look, it's a lot of times, how in the world did we get to this place? Well, usually we have unconsciously absorbed a non-Christian worldview. We've done that. And when people talk about indoctrination, all that means is teaching. And I'm in favor of teaching. Indoctrination sounds so dark, but what else do you call it when when you take a kid at, you know, age 4, age 5, or whatever, take them out of the home, put them with a bunch of peers 7-8 hours a day, and do that for, you know, 13 to 28 years around a certain philosophy that is not declared but assumed, they're going to come out believing something about something. And if that something isn't educated, if it's not informed biblically, it will end up unconsciously even being informed unbiblically. And that unconscious soon becomes conscious, because we act on what we believe. Education puts into students what will eventually process everything around them and then be expressed in the creative acts of the individual. Because we're all creators. God created us to be creators. And if what we create is built on a canvas or a foundation that is unbiblical, what we create will just be a louder expression of that unbiblical worldview, like the princess and the pea, if you know that one. You know that one? Princess and the pea? Did that when I was selling mattresses. Okay, all right, okay. So is truth an observed reality or a societal personal construction? If truth is not an observed objective reality, but something that we build either as individuals or a society, well, we don't have a whole lot to study. Nancy Piercy wrote in her book Total Truth, did I mention that you need to get her and send her to, okay, all right. The purpose of a worldview is to explain the world, not explain it away. The purpose of a worldview is explain the world, not to explain it away. What do we make of the world? There's a story, there's artifacts, there's a story all around us. What do we make of this story? The strength of faith is its object. So I'm going to ask you, this is a pure Minnesota question. Here's a Minnesota question for you. If you're walking out onto a lake, we do this in the winter. If you're walking out onto a lake, would you rather have a little faith in thick ice or a lot of faith in thin ice? You'd have a little faith in thick ice, because what happens if you got a lot of faith in thin ice? You're going to fall right through. If you have a little faith in thick ice, what happens to that little faith? It grows. We got to get the foundation right, and then it grows, okay? The strength of faith is its object. When we say that we believe, it's essential that we know what we believe in. And as Christians, our trust is in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins. And so we have an object of education. We have, that is the content, what we teach. We have a goal, what we're trying to get out of it. We also have a target. Who are we teaching what? Okay, so why education? This might be a little dry. It's under the heading philosophy of education. Why education? Okay, first of all, what is the nature of man? Is man basically good, needing information and opportunity? Or is he basically evil, needing redemption? Those are two totally different starting places for education. When you hear people talk like that, don't you? Well, they just need more opportunity, or they just need more education. Well, before you can educate somebody, who are you educating, how, with what, for what purpose, and who's doing the education? There's a lot of questions to answer. You can't just say, education, write a check, that'll fix it. Unless mankind is basically good. And I think really, if we have to argue that, I thought World War I took care of that. And if World War I didn't take care of it, the first presidential debate, it should have. So the nature of man is basically evil, needing redemption. Too soon? All right, okay. Is our goal in education behavior modification? Making children behave in ways that adults want? That's really what we want for our children. We want our children to behave well, because then they're more fun to be around. And then people say such nice things about the parents when the children behave well. That's what I'm in it for. It's like, yeah, bring it on, right? Okay. G.K. Chesterton, British apologist who's dead. You can't get him. So, but if you do, call me. Send him my way. Chesterton, he said if behavior modification is dependent upon providing an environment for a child, remember that boiling oil is an environment. Okay? All bets are off if that's your view of education. That's a great British line, isn't it? Boiling oil is an environment. Okay. We teach children how to read so they can learn what they need to know to get a job and make money. And if that's the purpose of education, I contend that first, it is insufficient, and secondly, that we're failing miserably. Education teaches precious eternal human souls how to think about the world and everything in it. All right, then this is the part I'm really, really apologetic for. This is the philosophy of education where I'm the president. Okay, and I'm showing you this. This is not an ad. I mean, Esther already went there, and I don't see it. But if you know a student, there's a table of information back here, and you can send them our way. It's a very short trip, and the weather is beautiful in October. So, so this is the philosophy of education. This is why we do what we do. The Free Lutheran Bible College and Seminary equips and teaches students in dependence on the Holy Spirit work through the means of grace. Now, already, that's not going to agree probably with the local public college or university. So it's just two different things, right? But we're laying our cards on the table. Rook cards on the table. Okay. The classes concentrate on the exposition and application of the gospel of Jesus Christ, through which God saves and sanctifies by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. One important application of the gospel is love for one another, with the result that graduates display an obvious love for the congregation. So there's love for neighbor and togetherness expression in the congregation. We teach in our church body that the congregation is the right form of the kingdom of God on earth. And you don't have to agree with that to be a Christian or to be my friend, but that's just it's just there. Okay? That's just what we teach. So we have a purpose here. And I'm not even gonna read this whole next thing to you. It's too much text. Vicky would tell David that. Okay. But here's the one thing I wanted to show you on this. We want academic excellence. We want that. But the goals go farther than that. We're not just looking for intellectual understanding, but we want to see every life of every graduate. We want to see the life of every graduate conformed more and more to the image of Christ. Changed, transformed, renewed by the Holy Spirit through the means of grace, through God's word, okay, and to the end that they become godly spiritual leaders. Homes, congregations, and the world need godly spiritual leaders. Now, I don't know what, I got a 10-year-old and an 11-year-old. I don't know what to want them to be when they grow up. I don't know what the noble professions are anymore. But, you know, Daddy, I want to be a statesman. I want to be a senator from the great state of Minnesota. It's like, well, I'd love to be excited about that, but have you seen what they do to those people? This is a scary world, isn't it? Hey, I want to be a Supreme Court justice. It's a hard life, right? Okay. But our world needs it. Our homes, our congregations, and the world need godly spiritual leaders. We talk ad nauseum in our church body about our pastoral shortage. You know what we have a shortage? We have a shortage of mature, godly lay leaders in our congregations. That's our biggest shortage. And so this is what we're trying to do. Both formal and informal instruction encourages students to deepen their personal devotional life and express their faith through active participation in local congregations, which provide opportunities for spiritual nourishment, worship, and service. Okay, so it's a long philosophy of education, but it's what we're trying to do. And I would contend that if you don't know what the philosophy of education is in your educational endeavor, you're just spinning your wheels. It might be good spinning, it could be bad spinning. But by all means, don't let somebody else spin their wheels on your territory if you don't know what they're driving. So, okay, that one was going nowhere fast. All right, There's a typo on the next slide. Anthropology, I spelled it wrong, and so I need to blame somebody for that. So Michelle, my wife, she made these slides. Don't tell, no, actually I did it. So, all right, three questions in education, and there's more, obviously, but from a biblical worldview, three big questions come up. The first one is this: theology. What is the nature of God? What is the nature of God? If God exists, we should probably know who he is, what he's like, how he interacts with the world. If he is infinite and personal, wow, there's something right there. That'll take a week of class right there, won't it? Infinite and personal. How does that work? Okay. Is he good? Okay. Well, if he's good, what does that mean? How does that goodness express itself in our world? In fact, everybody has a problem with evil. Have you ever heard somebody, you punt on Jesus, you know, like to get rid of Jesus because of all the pain and suffering and evil in the world? And some of you probably loved ones, and so it gets really personal and all that. And, you know, that's one of those conversations you have with almost everybody at some point in time. I just can't believe in a good, loving, all-powerful God in a world full of such pain, suffering, and evil. And I don't know if I can answer all of those questions, but I do know if you've got pain and suffering and you get rid of Jesus, what are you left with? Pain and suffering. Okay, so you didn't really solve your problem. You just shot the best solution you got, and so now you're looking at Plan B. And Plan A, you know, Plan B is always they're really bad when Plan A works really great. So it's a problem. Theology: what is the nature of God? And secondly, anthropology. Sorry, this is an apology for spelling anthropology. Anthropology. So, what is the nature of man? We just did that a little bit. He basically good, basically evil. That should be settled. Everybody's got a problem with the concept of evil and with the evil that other people perpetrate against them. And if there's anything we've learned from this pandemic, is that everybody in the world believes in an absolute right and wrong, and that everybody in the world is a legalist. Are you kidding me? All you got to do, can we talk about masks? Let's talk about masks. No, okay, no, you can't talk about masks. You can't do it. Everybody's got an opinion. No, I've got an opinion too. Mine is right, of course, and so is yours. And so we do that. We can't. Everybody, including people who have been telling us for 20 years that there is, or longer, 40 years, there is no such thing as absolute moral truth, now tell us that we shouldn't text and drive, and we got to wear a mask. Okay, and if you don't, you're going to hell. I don't believe in hell, but you're going there. And so it's how does our world get this? How do we? And the answer is, you know what? They're right. There are objective ethical truths that are to be found and are to be applied. And these are good things. They are right and wrong things. And all of this comes because there is a God who is himself good, who is personally involved in his creation and created us after his image. He loves us, issues and all. He loves us. And so if this is true, this is a fabric for education that cannot be ignored. Has to be taught. Anthropology. And if man is not as I have just described, then what is he? Okay. Oh, I missed something there. Francis Schaeffer, have you had him? Okay, no, okay, all right. Francis Schaeffer.
If I get hold of him suddenly.
Yeah, there it is. Yeah, you're with me on this. Okay, Francis Schaeffer, he said, there's a problem with man. That man is not God, but he's not non-man either. In other words, he's not God the creator. He is a part of creation. But there's something about man that is distinct from the rest of creation. We have animal characteristics, but we are not merely animals, and we're certainly not vegetable or mineral. Okay, we are not God, but we are not non-man either. And if God's story doesn't explain that, you can't just close the book and get on with your life. There's too much there you got to deal with. What is man? Okay. That's a fun one too, isn't it? It's fun. Okay. Soteriology. It's a big word. It means salvation. Study of salvation. How does God bring salvation? We teach that God did something on behalf of man. Theology and anthropology meet in the incarnation of Christ, through whom God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. And these are all chapters in the story of the world. Okay, we're going to build a worldview now. And some of this, I think, you've probably, John Stone Street was here a while back. He might have talked about this. As you look at the building blocks of a worldview, there's no and, obviously, because God is infinite and he created the world and everything in it. And our understanding is, you know, we see in a mirror dimly. So there's all kinds of things to talk about and all kinds of questions that we will still have. But there are some essential building blocks to a worldview. And note that I did not say a biblical worldview or a Christian worldview. This is stuff that everybody has to explain in some way, shape, or form. And philosophers have tried to do it for years. And the wise ones do it through the lens of God's word. I've got three columns on the screen, and there's a reason for it. In the first column, creation, fall, redemption, are categories that Reformed, Calvinist background philosophers and apologists have talked about in these categories, and I think they work really well. Creation, fall, and redemption. Creation, where did all this come from? Fall, what went wrong? And redemption, how do we make it right again? Or how do we go about making it right again? Or how does something else make it go right again? The middle column, and the spacing is there for a reason, that's from the Apostles' Creed, the first article. I believe in God the Father Almighty. Okay, so there's creation. And in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son. Okay, right? So, and it goes through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ and for the purpose of forgiveness. So there's redemption in the second article, and in the third, the Holy Spirit, the way we look at it, as Lutherans at least, it's the call. How does this become ours? How does God take this objective work outside of us and give it to individual humans? That God works through the Holy Spirit that way, and the third article deals with that. So you take the first column, creation, fall, redemption. You look at the second column, creation, redemption, and call from the Apostles' Creed. And then you got to add in one more thing, because you know there's something else coming for us. The God has prepared. In fact, when people are looking at pain and suffering and evil in the world, we need to agree with that. I mean, that's true. That's here. There's no getting around it, right? Okay. But if you want to look at the character of God, you need to look at what God created in the beginning. And he said it was very good. And then something happened. And we need to look at what God is preparing for us. I will wipe away every tear. Then we need to acknowledge that something happened in this time in between those bookends that we now look at as an immeasurable period of time with little bookends. But in godly, real perspective, it's an infinitesimally small sliver of time between two ends of eternity, if you can even speak of ends of eternity. Okay. Restoration. That God has prepared a place, and you've never met, as C.S. Lewis said, a mere mortal. All right, so I put them all together for my class, Apologetics in Christian Thought, and we teach this, creation, fall, redemption, call, restoration. And as a Christian thinker, to be able to explain that quickly, briefly, essentially, the stuff that is of the essence, it's really important. Okay. So I'd like to walk through these elements a little bit with you, if you would. Let's look at creation, first of all. How did we get here? And skip the details for now, but generally, and believe me, I have strong convictions, but just for now, skip the details, right? I can think of three options. First, an intelligence like God made us or put us here. That's one. Would you say that's one possibility? Okay, great. Okay, I won't tip my hand, but that might be what I think. So, okay. The second one is an intelligence like beings from another planet made us or put us here. Now, if you've never heard that out of the mouth of somebody who actually believes it before, you look forward to the day. It's loads of fun. And then you have to keep a straight face because you think they're joking, and they're not. Okay, now, the way to deal with that one, you could say, dude, what? Or you could say, okay, I'll grant you that. Where'd they come from? Just keep going until you get back to Krypton or wherever. All right. So the third one is this, the blind watchmaker, if you will, of matter and energy. Christopher Hitchens talks about matter and energy. This is about 20 years ago now, and other people have talked about this in more eloquent terms. But he said, there is a watchmaker to the universe. The universe bears the appearance of design, but it doesn't really. There is a watchmaker, but the watchmaker is blind. And that's a reference to William of Ockham, 14th century skeptical philosopher, who said there has to be a creator, because if you saw a pocket watch on the beach, you would know that there was a watchmaker. And said, there's just too much here for us to think there's no watchmaker. And Christopher Hitchens says, yeah, there's a watchmaker, but he's blind. It's a blind watchmaker of matter and energy. Okay, so how did we get here? Skip the details for now. Generally, that's your options. I can't think of any other options. So, but how did all that begin with? Again, skip the details. Supernatural creation, which says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's the beginning of our story. Okay. Or natural undirected processes that say something to the effect of, in the beginning, there was matter and energy. To say nothing of where that would come from. You see, there has to be a beginning of the story. No story ever begins. Everything just was. Luther, and this is Reformation weekend, and so if you're not completely sold on Martin Luther like I am, well, you're about to be. Okay, Martin Luther's explanation to the first article of the Apostles' Creed. Okay, it's good stuff. Okay, I believe that God has created me and all that exists, that He has given and still preserves to me my body and soul, my eyes and ears, and all my members, my reason and all the powers of my soul, together with food and clothing, home and family, and all my property, that He daily provides abundantly for all the needs of my life, protects me from all danger, and guards and keeps me from all evil, and that He does this purely out of fatherly and divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness in me, for all of which I am in duty bound to thank, praise, serve, and obey Him. And then all God's people said, this is most certainly true. Yeah, that's how we end it, right? So, okay. So this is Luther's explanation of creation. Without getting into all the details or anything else, and there's a time to talk about creation apologetics details. I really, really love this stuff. But when you're visiting with somebody, to get this building block right, and with children in age-appropriate ways, it's patently obvious to them that somebody built this place. It takes years and years of education to train them otherwise. So it's just that God created me, and and in this wonderful, loving way, you purely, what was it, purely out of fatherly and divine goodness and mercy. It's beautiful. Now, Luther said, if we really understood our Father who art in heaven, that we would need not the commandments or the creed. Yeah, probably overstated, but you know, Luther. Okay, all right. The second element is the fall. Again, note that I haven't said now biblical or Christian worldview. If you don't have a biblical worldview, if you don't have a Christian worldview, you still have to explain the fall. Something went wrong. We know that. I mean, I would much rather preach a funeral than a wedding. You too? What do you think? Bob, yeah. Funeral or wedding? Funeral, wedding. I think funeral for a couple reasons. Number one, I'm pretty sure that the guy's not lying to me. And couples trying to get married, they tell some stories, don't they? Yeah. It's like, that's great. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Okay. All right. I just a little, it's still too soon. It's been 6 years. And I'm still twitching a little bit. The things they tell you. And it's like, oh, no, we're not. Okay. All right. So, okay. So the other thing about a funeral is, you do preach the law at a funeral, but the law has been preached at a funeral. There's something wrong. Death isn't a friend. And sometimes we try to dress it up like it is. Like it's, and I hope I'm not stepping onto it, but the celebration of life thing, it's not like, I mean, it's not a sin if you call it a celebration of life. I understand. Okay, but if you're doing that to avoid the fact that Uncle Fred died, you need to address this, or it's going to take counseling. Okay, deal with it now, right? Okay. Uncle Fred died. There's a problem in this world. And it, even when Uncle Fred was a Christian, even when we grieve, but not as those who have no hope, even when we have all the assurances in the world that this is, yes, in the scheme of things, this is good, death is an unwanted invader, and it hurts. Now, if we take pain and suffering without a fall, and we rewind the videotape of where we are right now, and videotape is what we had before DVDs, which is what we had before streaming video. You rewind that videotape, and you get back to the beginning where God created the heavens and the earth, and we see a creator God who created a world with pain and suffering and evil and death. And you can tell a lot about a maker by the quality of the stuff he made. And so you end up saying that God's evil, or God has the capacity for evil, or that maybe what we call evil isn't evil, it's actually good. It's a bunch of religions try to do that one. Okay, but we won't get into that now. That's a different conference. Okay, so what do we do with the fall? Something's wrong. We got to explain this. One of our profs shot me this definition of sin from 1899. This is just this week. Steve Munfrom sent it to me. He says, people don't write like this anymore. Okay. Sin is the direst catastrophe of history. It has broken the harmony of the universe, set up rebellion against the divine government, torn asunder the bond of communion between the creator and the creature bearing his image, entailed upon all of Adam's posterity an irresistible bondage to evil with a guilty consciousness of their estrangement from their heavenly Father, and brought upon us death and all our woe. This catastrophe Christ came to undo. He has reclaimed a fallen world, sealed the doom of evil, enabled the sinner to return to his original state, reconciled the creator and the creature, and reestablished personal communion between God and man. This achievement is called the atonement. Wow. We don't write like that anymore, do we? Okay, that's what went wrong. My kids, when they were, they still got it, but Bob Coughlin kids CD called Theology. It's cute. Theology, Sovereign Grace Music, okay? And they have a song on there called Sin, okay? And my kids loved this album, but every time they get to that song, they wanted to skip it because it was a scary song. It was kind of cute scary. You know how you can do that if you're really good at stuff? But it was scary. They wanted to skip it. You know, I think sometimes that's what we want to do with our sin. We just want to skip it. We know it's not good. We know we want out of it, but we just want to hit, you know, skip or control Z or something like that. We just want to get out of it. That's not the way it works. And that's the next one. It's redemption. What's the fix for all of this? If something went wrong, how do we go about making it right again? Education is not sufficient to save. Okay, so it's like taking a bunch of career criminals in a maximum security prison and training them up real good, and then send them out so they're better at their craft. So you don't want to meet a self-actualized sinner. And I think sometimes in our educational approaches, that's what we're training. We're training up highly qualified, smart, intelligent, efficient, self-actualized sinners who have not met redemption and will not offer much grace to anybody they ever see. Redemption is at the center of the biblical worldview. Yes, there's a fall. Yes, something went wrong. And God set about immediately in the garden making it right again. This needs to be the center of our confession, too. I've really changed my approach on what we call apologetics. Apologetics is where we give reasons and answers, and you try to explain things. It's not, I try to tell my Bible college and seminary students, you don't have to know everything. I mean, even if you do, you don't have to have all the answers. Saying, you know, I don't know. that's refreshing sometimes. It's nice. It's like if our leaders would do that once in a while. You know, I don't know. Not sure what to do. But nobody will vote for you if you say that, even if it's true. So, I don't know. Okay. But, you know, I used to kind of walk people through the existence of God using the classical proofs and argue for the probable existence of material, of properties of material as opposed to just abstractions. I mean, I used to do this. This is silly. And you answer their objections about the reliability of Scripture, and you answer their objections about pain and suffering in the world, and you answer all their objections with the 3,000, because you can find a book, you can even Google it, 3,000 Bible objections or whatever, and you answer them all, one by one, and you answer them all perfectly, and they find, guess what they find? 3,001, right? And you know, when I was converted to Christ, it wasn't because I had all my questions answered, but boy, did I have questions. But I was converted to Christ, Brian Pearson, Hound of Heaven, God had convinced me through consistent preaching and teaching of his word that I was a sinner. And I had kind of come to that conclusion myself because I kind of hated myself. And you know, the good that I would do, I cannot do. You know, that the wretched man that I am. I kind of come to that place, and it's starting to justify myself and all that stuff. And it wasn't that I had all my questions answered. It's because God had convinced me that I was a sinner. And then he proclaimed to me the forgiveness of sins. And everybody else around me was telling me how to better myself or to assuage my conscience. But only Jesus was offering the forgiveness of sins. Nobody else even tries in world history. Okay. We need to major on the cross. Even though there's 100 other things that are really, really important, we need to make sure that people walk away from an interaction with us knowing that what we cling to at its core is the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins. And we can work forward from that. We can work backward from that. We can answer 1,000 questions. We can have ongoing conversations. But at some point in time, this friend, this family member, needs to come to a place where they understand that their only hope for eternity is that God became man to fix our mess, lived a perfect life, died of his own volition, so that he can justly grant his righteousness to us as he takes our unrighteousness onto himself. And that he died, he really died, and he really rose again, and he really is coming back. And this is tough. This is a hurdle for people. You know, people talk about miracles. I can't believe that book full of fairy tales. Well, you can cut to the chase on that one in a hurry. Because if what they mean by fairy tales is miraculous stuff, you skip all the stuff they want to talk about and say, I got a better one for you. God became man, died, and rose again. If you get rid of the miraculous or start to question that stuff, you're eviscerating the heart of Christianity. You're eviscerating the heart of your hope. If Christ has not been raised, our faith is in vain. We are of all men most to be pitied. And what God desires for all men is their salvation. And you can start with that. Your loved one that you're grieving over, your neighbor who thinks totally different from you, if any of you are on Twitter, just don't. Whatever these people are, you start with this building block that God desires their salvation. He loves them. And that he did everything possible to save them, everything necessary to save them, he has already done. And that the rest we proclaim, and we call them to that. We call them, we entreat them, we beg them. Okay. And that's call. Now, this is where Christians become less mere Christianity. and make things rather confusing. If you talk about the mechanics of how people are called, you know, there's different words for this. Election is the one that we as Lutherans tend to use, and Lutherans see election as all gospel, all good news, no bad news. And different people disagree with that. Good Bible-believing people, who I call friends, disagree with that. But skip the mechanics of it. It's divided every church body in the history of the world. Okay. I want to give you an example of this, and I'm going to go to Luther again. I just apologize. This is my apology phase. I'm going to go to Luther again. Okay, all right, okay. But, you know, I've always kind of wondered. When I was saved, I was 18 years old at a youth convention in 1991. The first night of the convention, I heard a message, and I consciously but not audibly said, "Jesus, I don't need any of this." The next night, I heard, it was Mike Brandt, so we know it's the same message, right? It's okay, same guy all week. And all I remember is that he read Isaiah 55, "Let the wicked man forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him seek the Lord while he may be found," right? Okay, that's a paraphrase. And this time, I consciously but not audibly said, "Okay, Lord, I'm done." And I've always kind of wondered, what happened? I didn't have any new information in 24 hours. Maybe a sunburn. I mean, I had consciously rejected the finished work of Christ in my life one night, and 24 hours later I said, "Okay, that's it, Lord, I'm done." And I kind of struggled with that until one of my seminary profs years later said something to the effect, "Oh, I'm gonna harm a cat again." Phil Haugen, he said, "You know, the best way to know how a cat works is to dissect it. But then that kills the cat." And what he said was, "Leave it alone. All you can say, finally and ultimately, is that God graciously came to you again, and just thank Him for that." And I think it's good to leave that kind of stuff there a little bit. Luther's explanation to the third article of the Apostles' Creed, which sounds so nerdy when you say it, but this is beautiful. "I believe that I cannot by my own reason or strength believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to Him, but the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with His gifts, and sanctified and preserved me in the true faith. In like manner as He calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth, and preserves it in union with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In this Christian church, He daily forgives abundantly all my sins and the sins of all believers, and at the last day will raise up me and all the dead, and will grant everlasting life to me and to all who believe in Christ." Oh, but I typoed that one too, didn't I? This is, it's like a thesis. This is most certainly true. Sorry. Okay. All right. In restoration, okay, that everything we experience right now with salvation, as great as it is, the hope that it is, can you imagine getting through dark days without Jesus? I just can't, okay? That our best days are not yet here. They're yet to come. And we long for that day. We long for that home. Revelation 21:5, "Behold, I am making all things new." And He is. We can trust our loving Heavenly Father with that. And I you got to admit, though, it all sounds a bit far-fetched if this is your first time through it. I mean, you can imagine how this could all be a bit overwhelming. You believe what? What again? Okay, oh, and He gave us a book. Okay, how convenient. So, but you know, it's true. And all of these things to walk through, to look for, to talk about, all of these questions to answer. That's why we educate. And I will admit to you that it's much easier to have an evangelistic encounter with somebody who knows the story. Unless it's become an inoculation to them, maybe, you know? But God's able to scrape the scales off of hearts, isn't He? And make hearts of stone into hearts of flesh? That's what he does. It's supernatural work. He does it through his word. But if we don't have the privilege of walking with someone educationally from the cradle or from the beginning of a session of school, God does give us the opportunity to walk with souls starting today, wherever they are in life. And that's what we're going to look at more tomorrow morning. The first session is going to be a little nerdy on how we know stuff. Epistemology. It's a fun word to say out loud. Try it. Epistemology. Go ahead, try it. Isn't it fun? It's fun. Epistemology. Okay. I even have an action song to go along with it. Okay. Epistemology. I do. Yeah. Now you want to come back. Nobody will be here. So, okay. And then we're going to look at how God takes all of this through us and through our congregations to souls around us. So we're gonna, that's what we're going to be looking at. So, okay. Last thing. We're going to spend some more time tomorrow on all of this. Redemption is the goal of Christianity, and so it informs our approach to education. We shouldn't expect everyone to agree with us on this. If you get on the local school board, it's going to be a long road, okay, back to Geneva. So, okay. But neither should we move away from this essential emphasis. We want students to know God through Christ, to view everything in the world and everything in the world through the lens of God's word, to the end that they will one day spend eternity in the presence of the Lord of this world and everything in it. And that's a high calling. If we do not have a biblical worldview, we will be teaching them another. And I pray that this will be a building block for you in understanding that worldview and trying to integrate it into your educational opportunities. So let's pray. God, thank you for tonight. Thank you for this opportunity and this congregation and everybody who has been a part of this session. Thank you, Lord, for their attention and their interest and their encouragement. And I ask, Lord God, that you would help us get really good at knowing and embracing your story and sharing it with others. Lord, may we rest tonight in your finished work, trusting you who is making all things new. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.